other name that is worthy to be praised.
Love your name, Jesus. Name of-
took my shame. You drank my cup and you bore my pain.
I'm so glad, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. You broke the curse. You broke the chains. In victory, in death, you rose again. You clothe me now in your righteousness, and I will always love your name,
name above all,
and I will always sing your praise.
Oh, I love you, Lord,
and I will always love your name. You bid me come, you make me whole, you give me peace, you restore my soul. Thank you, Lord, you fill my cup.
Okay, we come today to finish this series on the attributes of God. We could probably continue for another couple of years on it, but I think hopefully we've got the message across. There's something making noises at me. would you believe it if I told you that we started this series today 1 year ago, the 6th of September, which is tomorrow, so this Sunday last year. Time flies, doesn't it? Unbelievable. So today we're just sort of going to round it all up. Obviously we will look at another attribute of God. We're going to look at the perfection of God, and I couldn't think of anything sort of better to finish the series up on, talking about the perfection of God. But hopefully I think it's probably all recorded if you're interested in going back over those over the last year or so. So as always, I just want to reference the book by A.W. Tozer that I've used for these studies. And in this particular occasion, it's the Attributes of God, Volume 1. So I've one verse to share with you before we get into this. Psalm 50 again, it's just a short verse. Don't turn to it if you don't want to. Psalm 50, verse 2. And it says, out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Let's just read it again. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. You know that we have an unbelievable opportunity these days to spread the gospel throughout the world. We only have to just see what has happened in the last 18 months. And I don't know about you, but and you guys were online before that anyway, as many people were. But just over the last 18 months, the opportunity has been amazing through the forced closures, I suppose. And we've been communicating with all parts of the world so easily now. And every Tuesday at 3 o'clock, I'm on a Zoom meeting with friends from different parts, different continents every Tuesday. And it just blows my mind that it's so simple to do. Whereas we never really felt the need to do that before and hadn't explored it. So the point is that we have such an opportunity to spread the gospel around the world today through all of the mediums that you're well aware of. But, and again, I want to just ask this question by way of introduction, but at the same time, has the church, lost its fear of God? That sense of awesomeness, that sense of awful awesomeness, and the absolute desire for manifest presence. And you know, I've talked about manifest presence here before, and yes, we know that God in his omnipresence is always present with us, but we're talking about the manifest presence of God, the Shekinah glory that the Old Testament would refer to. And Tozer was writing 60 years ago, and what Tozer said 60 years ago, he actually questioned that if God didn't turn up to church on a Sunday, how many people would notice? And I think it's a fair question. Now, we know in God's omnipresence that he's always going to be here, yeah? But if God didn't turn up, would anybody notice? And I think it is something that we should consider. Would church for some people just continue as normal? You know, have we made our services so seeker-friendly? Have you heard of that term, seeker-friendly? Have we made our services so seeker-friendly that if God wasn't actually there, would we even notice, or would some people even care? I remember reading a book over the last couple of years by R.T. Kendall, and he said that there's nothing seeker-friendly about the gospel. Now, I'm not going to have a go at trying to create programs for people to come to church, because I was in church leadership and we often did that, and in my church we do. I suppose COVID has sort of changed things a little bit, but we would have had opportunities for people to come in to church for different reasons. So I don't have an issue with the idea of seeker-friendly service where we welcome people through the door, but the message of God cannot change. And I think that's the important piece that we should never forget. And I know that whenever I have watched things on television in the past, or have been to places, that very often we get entertained. Very often we get some sort of feel-good factor whenever we leave the building. And I have often wondered over the years, well, hold on a minute. Where's God in all of this? Actually, where is God in all of this? Because people need to change. We need to see evidence of change whenever people do that. So what about majesty? What about the divine and ultimate and awesome majesty of God? You know, Tozer argued that a common man has created a common God. And again, remember, he was writing this 60 years ago. He's probably turning his grave at the minute several times a day. And you sort of think, a common man has created a common God. And in our efforts to be radical, in our efforts to get out there, I suppose, sometimes we have created what I have coined the phrase a quasi-God. And a quasi means something that appears to be but is not actually. And so quasi-God, God with a small g. And again, I'm not, you know, whenever I teach, I just try to teach it as it is. And I'm not ever sort of picking on anybody, really. But it's just, it's a concern that I have. And you'll know that as I've taught over the last 12 months on this particular subject, that I come back time and time and time again to actually, have we lost sight of God as who God actually is? And things like terms of endearment, like Jesus is my boyfriend, or God is the man upstairs. Have you ever heard of the phrase Jesus is my boyfriend? if you Google that, you'll see a lot of stuff on Jesus is My Boyfriend. There's worship songs. There's a whole sort of thing dedicated to Jesus is My Boyfriend. I struggle. I really struggle with that. I really do. I had somebody who tried to argue the point with me one time about that. Not argue the point, because it's not, I don't argue about these things. Discuss the point with me that they thought that it was an acceptable thing, and give maybe some good reasons. I couldn't get there. I'm sorry I couldn't, because when we're talking about Almighty God of all heaven and all earth here, God is the man upstairs. Again, so wrong in my opinion. There's people, religious Jews in the world today, who won't even use the name of God full stop, because they revere his name so much. And yet often we degrade our God to colloquialisms, and it's just not appropriate as I would say it. And I know that the Bible refers to God as the Abba Father, which means Daddy God, and I absolutely love that. And it's that for me is not degrading God, because it's actually more about a complete reverence and the divine majesty of God. If you think about it, a child, generally speaking, first two words that they will ever have will be mama and dada. And if you have been a parent, been blessed to be a parent in this room today, you will know that that is the most awesome thing you will ever hear in your entire life. Anybody want to disagree with that? Yeah, all the kids are sitting going, I did all. I'm serious. As a parent, those are the nicest words you'll ever hear from your child. And then I suppose it goes all downhill after that. just saying. But those are the most awesome things you will ever hear. So think about our Father God. So whenever we speak about Abba Father, Daddy God, it is such a reverential thing. It is not in any way compared to the man upstairs or Jesus is My Boyfriend. Has the church forgot about it, the divine majesty of God? Has it all but lost its manifest presence? I believe that it has. I absolutely do. I think we've got so mixed up with so many other things. We've got so mixed up with but about almost a bless me culture sometimes as well. However, I believe that God wants to break out. And no, I'll rephrase that, because God will do what God is going to do. But I absolutely believe that we're on the cusp of a great outpouring of God. And I also absolutely believe that we as the church need to decide, are we in or are we going to be on the sidelines spectating? Because that'll be the choice. That'll be the choice. Has the church gained in volume but lost in sincerity? And the church is growing. There's expressions of the church which are shrinking, but the church in general across this world today, as you would expect, is continuing to grow, and so it should. But J.I. Packer once said, is the church 1,000 miles wide but only half an inch deep? And he's obviously using that as a metaphor as to, are we vast in number but shallow actually in our depth and our relationship with Almighty God and recognizing God in his divine majesty? And the challenge that hopefully I've brought over the last year is that you in your private study can actually get before God, can get before God and recognize and read and learn and study and understand how important it is for us to have him in that place of absolute divine majesty. We must recapture the perfections of God, the divine majesty. The church must return to that. Is the church weak, self-absorbed, or self-obsessed? If the church was on fire, and I know you're going to agree with this next statement here, and this is all just by way of introduction, by the way, so, but if the church was on fire, the world would be turned upside down. Would you accept that? Yeah, there was 12 disciples with Jesus Christ. Yeah, turned the world upside down. There was 120 in the upper room. The sad bit for me is that Jesus appeared to 500 at the one time, but there was only 120 in the upper room. And that's a statistic I think, unfortunately, is still true today. But there was 120 there, and the Holy Spirit was poured out in the second chapter of Acts, and we know that 3,000 was added to the church that day, and it just exploded. Do we want to be part of that? And if the church was on fire, and if we could absolutely get the understanding of the divine majesty of God, I'm telling you, this world would be turned upside down. Now, I believe with all of my heart that we, and I said again, we're on the cusp of a mighty outpouring of God across this world. But I also believe you can be a spectator, or you can be part of whatever it is that is going on. So what is it that perfection, or the perfection of God, is? So first of all, what does the word perfection mean? Webster's dictionary talks about the highest possible degree of excellence. The highest possible degree of excellence. So perfection, if you look at Webster's definition, perfection lacks nothing. It is fullness, it is completeness, it is perfection to be complete in your nature. So if you're a human being and you're perfect, although that may, we'll be getting onto this, that I don't think anybody can be perfect, but what it means in terms of the definition is that you can be complete in your nature. In other words, you can be the best that you can be. So you think of maybe a famous sports person or something like that there, who can be the best that they absolutely can be in whatever chosen field that they have. Or you could look at perfection in many different things, even other than humans. And so it's about being as good as you can be in whatever it is that you're intended to be. But that definition, Webster's definition, doesn't work for God. It doesn't work for God because God can never be a highest degree of anything. Yes, God is superior above all. Don't misunderstand me. What I'm saying is that if we look at God as a highest degree, then that would actually suggest a limitation for God. In other words, God's not the point of a pyramid where somehow we've got all of this creation in underneath, and then maybe the humans, us humans, are maybe just about here, and then God's here somewhere. That's not how it works, because that suggests that God's just better than us. God is beyond anything that we could ever imagine. God is infinite in all of his ways. God is completely separate to us as his creation. He is infinitely perfect in all of his attributes. So I'm not going to throw out a quiz there to go over the seven attributes. The seven attributes that we have covered over the last year. Do you want me to tell you, or do you want... Will I tell you? First one, sovereignty. Do you remember that? Few nods, whether you do or not. Second one was self-existence. Third one was imminence. No, transcendence, I think we went for. Then imminence, then grace, then justice, and today perfection. Now, there are many more, and I would, if you haven't already bought those books that I've been recommending to you, I would absolutely stress again, go buy those books. There's 20 attributes in them. And so the definition, as I've said, does not work with God because it would suggest that God has a limitation, and God has absolutely no limitations. Please really get into the idea of that, because we very often mostly live our lives like somehow God is limited, and he is not. God can do whatever it is that he wants and chooses to do. And very often we've got that knowledge here. Yeah. But we cannot get that knowledge very often, particularly when we're talking and dealing about ourselves. And it's amazing how we can always say, God's got it, yeah? But do we actually believe that God has got it if it's you or I looking in the mirror, facing the situation? There are no degrees in God. That's why this definition does not work for God, because there is no highest degree for God. And so God, as I've said, is not the point of the pyramid. Isaiah 40:25 says, to whom will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One. There can be no comparison to God, not on earth or in heaven. God is perfection, and he cannot be reproduced. And if you look at the second commandment, you will see very clearly where we're commanded not to try to reproduce God. Second commandment says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. And you know that whenever Moses was being given these commandments by God, what were they actually doing down in the desert floor? Whilst he was receiving it, they were creating a golden calf, yeah? You know the story. The interesting piece there is that we should never just see that as a story, because Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 10 that anything that happened to those guys, the guys in the desert back in the days of Israel, were written down so that we could learn from it. So it's very true that we can create for ourselves carved images. And it goes with the first commandment, which is not having any other idols before God. And you may think, well, sure, I'm not going to do that. I'm telling you right now, if it's written down, it's written down for a reason for each and every one of us. And is it possible that we can create images in our mind of Christ? This tells us, again, just as an aside, this actually tells us that we should not create images of God and Jesus in our mind, because that is an image that is being created other than what is in heaven. And we could talk about that all day, and we'll not get into it now, but the point I'm making is we have to have God in his divine majesty, worshiping him in his attributes, rather than creating some sort of image for him. And so the Bible uses the word perfection in so many ways, but when it comes to God, there is a limitation in the language. Okay, so let me give you an example of that. Matthew 5:48, Sermon on the Mount. Jesus speaking says, "You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect." Now, there has to be a limitation in the language there, because if we read it just as it's written, that's saying that somehow I can be perfect like God. Now, that's just an impossibility. Would you all accept that? Mm-hmm. And so the verse here suggests perfection like God, but that's not what it's saying, because even if we could become perfect, then we are infinitely still short of the perfection of God. So what Jesus is actually saying is that we need to be the best degree that we can be in order so that we can worship a perfect God. That is it's a sanctification verse, really, if you think about it. It is that each and every day that we get up, that we are determined to serve God better than we did yesterday, that we are absolutely determined to do the right thing in whatever situation that we're faced in. And we all face situations every day of the week. And I'm not talking about these four walls on a Sunday. I'm talking about tomorrow morning when the rubber hits the road, whenever we're faced with a scenario and we can do the right thing or the bad thing. Are we going to choose the right thing? And none of us are perfect. That's what we're saying. Mm-hmm. And we may fall, we may fail. But we've got to be absolutely determined whenever we get up tomorrow that whatever situation we face, we need to do the right thing. What is the right thing? Get into the Word of God, because the world is very confusing right now. Everybody expects you almost to bend the rules. Bend the rules is acceptable, isn't it? No, it's not. It is not acceptable. And as Christians, we have to hold ourselves to a much higher standard, because trust me, the world will notice. You ever notice that everybody's just very blasé until you do something wrong? Yeah, very blasé, doesn't matter. And then you do something, and what are you going to get accused of? Oh, hold on a minute, you're not supposed to be doing that. And it's obviously ironic and hypocritical from the people who suggest it, but actually they've got a point, because we should be held to a higher standard. We should be the best that we can absolutely be before God. And it's not about reaching that place of sinner's perfection, because that, I believe, also is an impossibility. But we need to be like Christ, yeah? Because I actually believe as well, and I suppose today we're having just more of a discussion around the closing of this series. I actually believe as well that if we can do that, if the closer to God that we can get, the more of God we're going to carry. Is that? And you've read stories maybe like I've read over the years where the great Bible scholars and Bible teachers of the day, Smith Wigglesworth, great one of the guys I would read about, and if you don't know anything about him, go and read about him. Smith Wigglesworth, born in 1859, plumber, uneducated, didn't start his ministry till he was in his 50s. His wife taught him to read, couldn't read, only ever read the Bible. But what an anointing, if we read about is true, what an amazing man he must have been, because people bowed down beside him, but it was nothing to do with him. It was the God that he carried. That's getting close to the perfection of God, but not the perfection of God, about being perfect as close as he can be in terms of his desire to be like Christ. Does that make sense? And so, as I already said, there is a limitation in the English and the original language in Scripture when it talks about our perfection. Because when we say, as I've said, when we say a human is perfect, we're actually saying that they're the best that they can be. And so Tozer says, when we apply perfection to God, we mean that he has unqualified fullness and completeness of whatever he has. He has unqualified plenitude of power. He has unqualified fullness of wisdom. He has unqualified knowledge. And he has unqualified holiness. And we could go on and say that God is perfect and unqualified. He has unqualified immanence, transcendence, omnipresence, we could just go on and list all of the attributes, and God is perfect in all of them and completely unlimited in all of them. And so God is perfect and full in all of his attributes. His ways are completely beautiful and perfect. There is no one or anything that is better than God. You know, I hope that I have raised your appetite and desire to worship the God that we have in heaven, because I don't want you to limit God if you're doing that. Because very often we limit God with our human minds. And God is unlimitable. And we have him inside of us. The Bible tells us so clearly that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. I've told you before that it's not some sort of cosmic battle between the devil and God. That's just not the case. Because God is ultimate being. The devil might be fighting with the other angels. The devil might be getting some leeway from God just to have a go at us sometimes, but it's all within God's parameters. And so the one thing, as we come towards the end of this series, that I really want you to understand is that we serve and we have within us an unlimited God, completely unlimited. And so whenever we go out our door in the morning, and I know it's easy as humans to think that things may not go the way that we expect them to go, or whatever the case might be, never lose sight of the fact that God is the supreme being of all of this earth, and he is in control of all things. Absolute control of all things. And we need to start understanding that. And yes, we have to do what we're asked to do. We have to come before God. We pray, we ask God, we worship, we do all of those things. But God is the supreme being and completely perfect. And so the verse again that we've read for our text today, out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. What honors God is not only perfect, but it is beautiful. You know, the closer to God something gets, the more beautiful it becomes. That is why Scripture is beautiful. Why? Because it reflects and honors God. Studying God is a beautiful thing. Why? Because it makes the studier honor God. Worshipping God is a beautiful thing. Why? Because it makes the worshiper honor God. And we could give you a whole list here, praising God, praying, witnessing. Why is it a beautiful thing? Why? Because it honors God. And so whenever we look at what's the greatest commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is likewise unto the first, that we should love our neighbor as we love ourselves. What does God want? He wants us to love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. That is your responsibility and mine within this room today. That is it. Yes, we have to go into the world. We have to share that with other people. But our responsibility and what God wants is for us to love him with all our hearts, souls, mind, and strength. And that becomes a very beautiful thing. Yeah? Psalm 90:17, and let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us. And beauty centers around Christ as well whenever we look at it in Scripture, because the story of the cross is completely beautiful. Why? Because of what it is. The shedding of the blood of Jesus on that cross is the most beautiful thing. The atonement, we've talked about it in the past. We can't describe it. We can't explain it. We know that it happened. I would imagine everybody in the room today has experienced it. But it's a beautiful thing. Yeah, visually, it may have been a gruesome thing. But spiritually, it is a beautiful, beautiful thing. Because it is the revelation of salvation for those who choose to believe. Why? Because it's perfect. Because Jesus is perfect. You know, heaven is perfect in the revelation and presence of Jesus. And hell is ugly because God doesn't live there. In his presence, we've talked about this the last time, in his omnipresence, God is everywhere, but God doesn't live there. And so heaven is beautiful, heaven is perfect, hell is ugly. Earth for now is caught halfway between. It's pretty ugly, I would suggest. Pretty ugly. But the people who live here need to decide if they will seek the beauty of heaven or the ugliness of hell. And I would imagine, again, just throwing it out there, I may be wrong to assume, but I would imagine most people in here have accepted the beauty of heaven. But if you haven't accepted the beauty of heaven, if you have not accepted the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross for us and in our place, and if you're watching online today, you can choose the beauty and the perfection of heaven just by accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord. It's such a simple thing. Too many people make this such a difficult thing. It's not. There's nothing difficult about it because it's supernatural and it's perfect. All we have to do is believe that Jesus did it for us. That's it. That's what the Bible says. There's nothing difficult about it. All we have to do is believe it. And so if you're in the room today and you don't know Jesus, your own personal Savior, cry out to him where you're sitting right now. Ask him into your heart. If you were a believer once in your life and you've slipped away from that, just come back to him. Come back to him in the quietness of your heart right now in this moment. And recognize that the God of all heaven and this whole entire universe, who is within you in his omnipresence already, but he wants to be the King and Lord of your life. And so that your life will be turned upside down, I'm telling you. What is it Moody said? Well, he actually stole it off a young Englishman, but Moody said, this world is yet to see one man completely sold out for God. And you've heard me saying that here before. Be sold out for God. If you're watching online, be sold out for God. Give your life to him. Don't leave it too late. There are too many people who are slipping away. I spent 27 years in the fire service. Old people will die, but young people may. And I can assure you in 27 years, I've been to many a scene where the people didn't think they weren't coming home that day. And they weren't all old. In fact, lots of them were quite young. And so if you do not know Jesus as your own and personal Savior, invite him into your heart and life right now. Contact the church here. I'm sure they'll give you a bit of extra help or speak to a Christian friend. And so just to summarize all of what it is that we've talked, and don't worry, I'm not going to say all of what it is. I know that's a year's worth of stuff, so you don't have to worry about that, okay? But just to sort of summarize everything that we've said this morning and just what we've covered over the last year is that holiness, beauty, perfection, and all of the other attributes that we talked about are all tied up in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Jesus is wonderful. Yeah? Not mate, he's not your boyfriend, because that's a colloquialism. For me, it's irreverent. But Jesus is wonderful. He is your Savior. God is your Father. The Holy Spirit is your Comforter. We need to start living our lives like we believe it. Jesus is perfect. He is beautiful in all of his attributes. So is God. So is the Holy Spirit. And that is, as a teacher, that's what I need to teach. And you know that that is what I teach. And as hearers, that's what we need to hear. Yeah? And how do you hear? Maybe half an hour on a Sunday morning, but you hear through the Word of God. Yeah, half an hour is not, that's only half an hour, and there's another 167 and a half between now and next Sunday morning. And so we need to learn of God for ourselves. And so God can deliver us from many, many things. And we know that, and we see it in Scripture, and you've witnessed it, and we all understand that, and probably all of us in the room have been delivered from stuff. He can answer prayer, but those things should pale into insignificance in the light of a perfectly wonderful God and Savior. Our priority, our first thing every day should be, God, it doesn't matter what's happening to me today, I'm going to serve you. Yeah? Be nice if you blessed me. Be nice if you looked after me. It'd be absolutely fantastic if you answered these prayers. But God, my priority, absolutely, when I get up tomorrow morning, when I leave this building today, is God, I want to serve you. Doesn't matter what else happens. You think of right around the world this day. You think of some of the people who are waking up this morning to spend another 23 hours in a container because they're Christians and they're locked up. Yeah? They're not complaining. In fact, if you look at the history of the church that is persecuted, many of them will tell you that they don't want to be freed from their persecution. They will, if you read into it and understand. They pray for us. They pray for us that we'll actually get a grasp of who it is that we serve and who it is. And it doesn't mean that we don't pray for our brothers and sisters around the world today. Of course we do. Look at Afghanistan over the last few weeks, and it's going to be horrendous for the Christians in Afghanistan. There's no doubt about that. And of course we should pray for them. But everything in our life should pale into absolute insignificance based, except for the light of a perfectly and a wonderful God and Saviour who we worship. He is the Saviour for those who believe. You're only here for a short time. Focus everything on God. It is for eternal life in heaven. We need to get beyond ourselves. We need to get beyond the spiral of self-indulgence. Your life and my life should be about God and God alone. It is God who brings the increase. It is not my word. It is not my church. It is not my salvation. It is not your word. It is not your church or your salvation. But it is God's. Yeah? It is God's. And we have an absolute privilege to be part of that process. And we should see it as such. You know, if we have a low or an underview of God, then I'm telling you, that's what's going to be presented to the world. Why would the world be interested in that? Why would the world be interested in an underview or some sort of minimized God or some sort of quasi-God or God with a small g or Jesus is my boyfriend? They're not. They're not. It's about entertainment. And again, I'm not going to name names around this world today because none of us are perfect, including me, including all of us in this room. But I'm telling you right now, and I hope I haven't stood on any toes today. I probably have. Doesn't matter. I've got to that point in my life where I'm turning 50 soon. I'm past the point of caring. Sorry, forgive me for even saying that. I know I don't look 50. I can see the shock on all of your faces. Yeah? No, seriously not. No way. A big lad's not 50. Not even close. Come on. And I know today, I suppose, we've just been sort of rounding this series up. I hope you've enjoyed it. I certainly have enjoyed presenting it. I've enjoyed studying it. I've enjoyed learning for myself. As I was saying to someone during the week, the teacher is only one page ahead of the student, all right? Don't think we know everything, because we don't. But I just love studying myself. But can I encourage you to get into studying the Word of God for yourself? There's nothing better than to have that. Can I pray for you and we'll be closing prayer? Yeah. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this time we've had this morning. Lord, we thank you for your presence. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for every last thing you tell us in Scripture, Lord, that you impress upon us, Lord. We thank you for your salvation, Lord. We thank you for the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. Lord, we thank you that we can call you our God, our Abba Father, Lord. And we recognize that you and all of your perfections, Lord God, you and your infinite beauty, Lord, you and all of the attributes that we have discussed and haven't discussed, Lord. Lord, we just thank you that you are within us, Lord. And we know that the word tells us that you live within us and that you're greater than anything that can come near us to attack us, Lord God. And help us to recognize, Lord, that each and every day is actually about us serving and worshiping and loving you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Lord, recognizing that we need to be more like Christ and that this world will see you in us. And it's not about our comfort for the 70, 80, 90 years that we might get here on earth. But Lord, rather it's about an eternity and an eternal promise, Lord, where we can live for you forever. And Lord, I just pray in the mighty name of Jesus, a special blessing over the people that are within this room today, those who may be watching online, Lord, that they will get an absolute grasp and an understanding and an urgency to be completely sold out for you, Lord, so that we can be partake in the great outpouring, Lord, which is already happening across this world today, but absolutely will happen, Lord, across this world in the coming days, weeks, months, years, whatever it happens to be. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that people will be saved in every corner of the world, that every tribe and nation will fall before you, Lord. And if there are absence of witnesses, Lord, that you will, as you do, reveal yourself in visions and dreams to people who have never heard about you, Lord, so that they will flock to you in their millions and their billions. Lord, we want to see heaven populated and hell plundered, Lord, because you win. You always win. You always have won. You always will win,
Lord God, we are your servants. Use us whatever way you see fit, Lord God. Help us to live for you in every breath that we've got and every word that we speak. And Lord, everything that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.